Good afternoon, everyone. I, Preksha Rai, student manager of the MHRD, feel deeply honored to introduce Dr. Harish Pant, who is present amongst us. Dr. Harish Pant is the managing director of Hampson Industries Private Limited, Bangalore. He is a fellow of Institution of Engineers and corporate member of IET, SAE, Aeronautical Society of India, and various other institutions, trade bodies, and associations. In addition to his responsibility at Hampson Industries, he is a mentor, sustainability evangelist, poet, author, blogger, columnist, keynote speaker, blockchain, cryptocurrency, and fintech enthusiast. He has developed global vision and sustainability model and further carrying out research on three currencies model for social, environmental, and economic impacts. He has 33 years of global experience in aerospace, automotive, and steel sector. He has been awarded with Outstanding Corporate Award by MTC Global, IMMAI Operational Excellence Award, Mother Teresa Excellence Award, and Award for Industrial Development. Sir, I welcome you with glory and honor. May I request you to enlighten us with the words of wisdom? Sir, this is all yours. Thank you.
So, good afternoon to all of you. It's a pleasure to be here with such a vast number of management graduates in front of me. So, only one thing is not allowed. After food, sleeping. Right? So, I'll be looking to each face. Right? So, help me and motivate me to speak by not sleeping. Promise?
Yes, sir.
How many of you want to be an entrepreneur?
Sir, so much for travel.
Quite a lot. Good. So I'm sure at least the people, the students who want to be entrepreneur, they would not have taken so much of a food, and they would be at least not sleeping. Right?
Sure, sir.
Okay, so I'll start my session here, Leading and Thriving in Digital Era.
Light off.
Okay.
Back.
Okay, this one. I thought that one. Good. Right. So, I will start by saying, Gita, how many of you have read Gita?
Yes.
Have you heard about Gita?
Yes.
Good. So, in Gita, right? Arjun was frustrated because he did not know. Then he got enlightened by Krishna's Upadesham. Then also, he did not know, but now he was blissful. Right? This insight helped him to act, start the war. Action with purpose. So, out of this session, I would like you also to get some insight, some wisdom, through which you can focus in your work, whatever you choose in your life. There's a famous book, Stay Hungry, Stay Foolish. Simply put, be curious. If you don't know, ask. When you know, it does not mean that you will know all. But the difference will be, if you have insight, the difference will be, you will be blissfully knowing that you don't know all. Right? So, I'll be covering this journey in 5 steps. shifting horizon, digital era, five takeaways, Q&A, still if you have, and future connect. In the picture you are seeing this bus. It's made by Protea. It has 1100 miles range. Right? Only day before yesterday, this was in the news. So, lot of paradigms, lot of changes are happening, lot of disruptive changes are happening. Things which we thought impossible are becoming possible. There is nothing called impossible, it looks like. Shifting horizon. This you see, the twin cancers which is affecting society and the economy worldwide. One is the high debt and there is no growth happening. In USA, USA is having a debt of $23.4 billion. They have only yesterday announced that they will be issuing government bonds to the tune of $4.3 trillion. Okay. This kind of a contraction is happening. China economy is hard landing. Economists are still arguing whether it will be soft landing or hard landing. But one thing is for sure, is China's GDP growth will be reducing year after year. Brexit, we know that it is going to impact not only Europe but UK both. Geopolitical. Oil is going to have such a dramatic impact throughout the globe. A lot of US companies have done trillions of dollars of investment. Like BP is there, Shell is there, like that many other companies are there. Suddenly they find that because of focus on solar energy and focus on electric vehicle, oil requirement is going down, will be going down in every 5 years, dramatically. So a strategic asset, the strategic investment of trillions of dollars, people are finding it will not be strategic. For India, it is very strategic to reduce oil consumption dramatically. That's why there is a strong push from the government to go all electrical by 2030. German companies, they have invested 15 billion euros because they also have huge dependency of oil from Russia. And whenever the USA threatens to act towards Russia or China, European countries, they say, don't do it. Because the moment petroleum supply stops Europe, the whole region is going to be in a standstill. So they also want to reduce the dependency on oil. Mobility is going for a massive change. We are seeing Uber, SoftBank. They have collected $100 billion. And out of that, they want to invest $10 billion into mobility, Uber. Now you can imagine the kind of money flowing in mobility, the kind of disruption is going to happen all over the globe. The whole concept of ownership of the product is going to completely change. We are seeing employment-less growth. Growth is happening, markets are booming, our stock market is also booming, 32,000 plus, but employment is not there. It's a big concern to Prime Minister, to the whole cabinet ministers, to the whole country. Globalization, the features of globalization, they are turning into productionism. And it is for the right reasons. So much contraction is happening in economy worldwide. They don't have any other option than to contract it, move to protectionism. Global warming. Paris 23. USA is trying to withdraw from this Paris Agreement. They are saying that they don't want to fulfill the commitment that they had made 2 years back. We know about Bluetooth, lot of cardless payment. Even to the extent Google is developing an app, a device, or means, through which you, without even taking out mobile phone, you should be able to make payment. So, Bluetooth means connectivity is increasing by day. And who could have imagined? One day I was looking to my daughter, trying to understand what she is doing in her mobile. And she said that, don't worry, I'm not playing Blue Whale. A teenager from Russia, she developed this game, and a parent sitting in Bangalore trying to understand whether her daughter is playing her game or not. So this kind of a globalization world we are living. I have gone to many white papers and I have been to quite a few seminars where all economists agree that China, USA, India, or China, India, USA. Out of these two, the whole economy will develop. The ranking will be China number one for sure by 2050. USA or India, there's a bit of a doubt. And whoever is takes up question number two, the third one will be in that direction. So this is set. All the macroeconomic players, if you see worldwide, they point to this. All the economists are very much optimistic about this. So, at present we are $2 trillion economy. It is going to be a $5 trillion economy by 2025 and by $20 trillion economy by 2010, by 2040. So now you can see the $2 trillion becoming 10 times. So we have not seen real economic progress in our country yet. We have just started. We are just taking baby steps. That's why we have to change our whole paradigm. How do we see the future job creation, businesses, entrepreneurship, so and so. Whole country is in a startup. Whole country is startup. If you see the measures which have been taken by this government, all point to this direction that whole country is in a startup mode. There are some policy decisions, there are some strategic decisions being made. Government is coming with the paperless, cashless, faceless, frictionless kind of a portals. Standards have been developed to develop those services and portals at a central level, at a state level. Some of the states are very progressive. Some of the states are struggling to come out with those measures. We see that education is going to dramatically change. By the government wants 20 universities to be world class, 10 in private and 10 government funded. So all this points that this is just a starting. India is getting set. My assumption is, my view is that by 2020, India would have done these macro changes, macro setting, and afterwards it will leap into a real T20 kind of a pace. So India will be in 2020 mode, T20, literally. Energy, solar drive would have taken a very strong footing. And all the models which are going to be introduced by automotive companies, those are going to be electrical 2018 onwards. By 2020, you will see some lakhs of vehicles getting sold which are electrical. Also, there will be a softening of ownership concept in India. We hardly use our vehicle, 5%, 10% in the whole day. So, with the Uber, Ola, those service providers coming, mobility service will be the mainstream where people will stop buying vehicles. So, from 2020 onwards, suddenly you will find those critical factors are in place and India has started really playing very fast. when this kind of a growth will happen, there will be breakdown and there will be breakthroughs. You can see the sign of stress in a lot of companies. You can also see a lot of innovations happening in many industries. If you want to be an entrepreneur, you can see those areas, those industries, those sectors where they are under stress because of digitalization, because this structure cannot withstand, and also the areas where new technologies are evolving. Just to give you an idea that 70% of the companies in the Standard & Poor's 500 rating, 70% of those companies are going to get replaced by new companies. And my sense is that at least 30 to 40% companies in India are going to get closed in 3 to 5 years. And many of them will be very confused what to do. Do you agree? The simple reason is that tax saving had been a very, big figure, 30-35% of tax. If you could somehow save the tax somewhere or the other, it used to cushion a lot of inefficiencies in India. As the GST comes in, as the direct taxes comes in, as India moves to a very digitized economy, those avenues will not be there. And then one has to compete in terms of product quality, in terms of innovation, in terms of creativity. This is in 1932. This was supposed to be the most sophisticated buggy in USA. And in the other side, you see the Curiosity, which was launched to Mars. Right? Now the evolution, if you see, of 85 years, in that, now people are talking about machine learning, autonomy. Even the scientists which are sitting in NASA, when they have to track Curiosity, they find it very annoying that it will keep on sending data every half an hour and they have to keep on giving their instructions. So they say, no, this is very repetitive, we are not going to do it. What we will do is, we will equip it with machine learning, we'll make it autonomous so that it can take its own decision and manage itself. And only once in a day, the data can flow in the NASA center. Manage. Leading and managing, I think you might be studying in your lectures. People say, do you manage? Some people say, do you lead? Then people say that it is the two sides of the same coin. The fundamental is, if you see in the back of all the automation happening, all the changes happening, nobody is ready to pay for that. Managing is becoming costlier, right? Once the AC was not working in my home, so my wife said, do something. I fumbled with the remote and I could not do anything. And she said, do something with the AC. I said, there is no button, nothing. What you can do? Either you can operate through remote or there is nothing to fiddle with. So in the same way, what is going to happen is, when things go autonomous, they are self-managed, they have machine learning, they have cognition abilities, you will find there is nothing to manage. Either you lead, or you do some creative work, you do some innovation, simply managing is going to get possible. I know that most of the leaders, they do a lot of managing now. Morning meetings, evening meetings, Friday meeting, monthly meeting, monthly reviews, budget planning, business planning, you name it, lot of managing happens. So 90% of the work, even of a top leader, goes in managing the things. But things are going to change. Leaders will not have a time to manage, and they don't have to. Nobody is paying them for managing it. Sometimes managers who are leading, that is also going off. Because when the cognition happens automatically, decisions happen automatically, things get integrated, hyper-connected, there is nothing to lead and manage kind of thing. So what is going to happen? Leaders will be leading, creative people will be innovating, doing something wonderful, new, or there will be a repetitive value creation. And all this repetitive work will be done either through automation or by few set of inputs. Entrepreneurship is going to be the main thing. Progressively, you will find the jobs are getting dried up. And they will slowly, you will find that the people who have entrepreneurship mindset, they will progress. Even in the job, it will be mandated, it will be desired from you that you have those entrepreneurship qualities. Even the job which you do, you should do it with an entrepreneurship mindset. That will be the basic requirement from the job profile. So now, if you want to be an entrepreneur, basically what you are trying to do is, you are understanding what is the value proposition you are going to offer, what is the pain area you are going to solve for a customer, right? Then you have to see from two perspectives, scope or scale. Once you have defined the scope, if you can scale, then only you are an entrepreneur. Otherwise, you are a simple businessman. So that's why scoping and scaling both are important aspects in entrepreneurship journey. Nowadays, current platforms are integrated, distributed, and decentralized. Maybe one of them or all of them are possible through digital platforms. Then what happens is, with this digital platforms, you connect it with a digital factory, and then what you are trying to do is not the only outcome of the business, but you also see that whether you have been able to impact society, environmental, or economy. All three impacts are getting more important. So the outcome of business is important, of course, but beyond it, you should be able to impact society, environment, and of course, economic impact you must be able to. Digital twins. How many of you have heard digital twins? If I come maybe after 5 years in this forum, I may be coming with my digital twins. Right? Because whatever combination, Google knows a lot about me, where I am, when I have reached, what are my likings. Many, many data Google knows about me, right? But I don't know about myself. I have to go to Google to find out what they know about me. But a time is coming when I will carry the digital twin myself and it will assist me in what I am doing. Just to give an example of how the technology is transforming the whole world, I will give an aerospace example. GE has developed an engine which used to have 485 parts. And I am talking about engine parts, which run in a very high RPM, very severe conditions of temperature, humidity and all. That they were able to reduce it to 12 parts. So it means that development time has dramatically reduced. All the performance parameters have been dramatically improved. 285 parts, you get 12 parts. And they are all additive manufacturing. Alcoa used to be a tier 4 supplier for aerospace industry. And engine casing used to take about 18 to 24 months of manufacturing. Now they do it from concept to the first finished casing in their hand in a matter of weeks. If any alteration is required, they do it in days. So, 4-tier journey has been reduced to a 1-tier stage chart. You get finished product in hand in a matter of weeks. So this is transporting the full manufacturing structure. So many things, cognition, many things are repetitive, your technology will do. What you have to do, define the next. Right? There was an ad, I just took a photograph, day for yesterday in Economic Times, where now, and I was interacting with one of my doctor friends, he says that whenever a patient comes now, we simply have a software where we just put in the customer, patient's data, and it gives us a lot of suggestions, a lot of medicines, and it automatically prompts what to prescribe to a patient. So this was not possible before, right? So what we do, we have to change it dramatically. What we have been doing 5 years from now, what we do now, that has changed dramatically. I know my days in General Motors, I used to have a secretary. She used to do a lot of my report making, data collection work. But I don't have now secretary for quite a long time. All things are managed by me. So nature of work is going to change dramatically. So we have, whatever actions we do in a day, it has to be 10 times, 100 times kind of a value. So my suggestion to each one of you is that whatever is repetitive, forget it. It is not going to happen. Take the help of technology and start focusing on very high value creation work. Second thing is doing your graduation, and that is good enough for your life. Those days are over. You have to be a continuous learner throughout your career. See, Jane, I am doing a research work with a few people in MIT, and it relates to this sea impact. And I have come up with a concept called Chief Convergence Officer. I believe that in coming 5 to 10 years, we will have Chief Convergence Officers, where they will be responsible for creating social impact, creating environmental impact, and creating economic impact, all three impacts together. And so in the future, the roles will be very different to what we see today. Maybe a platform creator, you may be an innovator, you may be a storyteller, Gen X. So all the traditional roles of HR, marketing, all those things are going to be over. I was in one of the sessions where a wizard in marketing, digital marketing, he was asked, what do you see the future happening in digital marketing? And he says that in the future he sees a person with the academic background, a person with the digital background, they will be running the marketing function rather than people with the marketing expertise. Because everything will be big data, data analytics, data science, and for all those things, you require a different set of expertise rather than traditional marketing role. So, moving to the next topic, the digital era, Industry 4.0, it is my background. People say that in next 20 years, $10 to $15 trillion of GDP, global GDP, will come from Industry 4.0. This is a snapshot of Industry 4.0. The kind of changes we have seen in the first industrial era, which was 1850 to 1910, 4 times of that change is expected now in the next 15 years. We have seen various waves of evolution in human society. First wave was the product, second was the talent, third was the knowledge, fourth we are now hyper-connected. Everything is getting hyper-connected in digital factory era, and the next wave is going to be quantum or spatial. A lot of research is happening in quantum field. I'm connected with some of them. And China is moving very fast on this. Europe is doing a lot of work. NASA has developed quantum computing. And when you go for quantum, then how they define, how they work in quantum, it gets a semblance of spirituality as well. I don't know whether you are able to see what is here, but it says that all the repeat data collection, data processing, repeat work, that will get automated. And some of the jobs which are very professional, where you require a very high skill set, that only will be not automated. In Industry 4.0, what you do is you connect people, process, technology. Then you go to the next level where you connect interface, people, machine, those things. So what happens from a production plant to a finished product, all happens in an automated way. All the things connected, interconnected, supply chain gets connected. Future factory will look like this, with the least amount of human contacts and control. I remember that I was in Japan in 89. At that time, I know that Denso plant used to work 24/7 with 99.7% of the capacity utilization. So now the world has moved much better and much higher. So future factories will be all interconnected, everything robotized, all the repetitive work will be done by automation. Digital supply chain will be also looking the same way as the digital factory looks like. It will be very difficult to understand where the manufacturing has stopped and where the supply chain has stopped. So it is all in one. Everything is moving continuously, interacting, influencing. We see nine different, when we talk about Industry 4.0, it's basically a combination of nine technologies coming together and impacting it. 3D example I have already given you. Everything is moving to cloud. Robotics is happening in a big way. Right? Ford company, which is in Gujarat, it has 95% automation. It has a very less manpower there. So all the future factories of electrical vehicle is going to have 1/100th of the component, which is a normal vehicle, a petrol and diesel vehicles have. So with the 1/100th of the component, you can understand the kind of automation will happen. Tesla produces highest value per cubic meter space in the world. And they are 6 times smarter than anywhere in the world. With Industry 4.0, of course you get productivity, you get flexibility, quality, and speed. These are the four coordinates which directly gets impacted when you implement Industry 4.0. This data is based on CEO's interviews. They were asked, what is the most demanding task in Industry 4.0? And majority of them, they said that culture of the company is the most difficult thing to tackle in implementing Industry 4.0. Because the kind of changes we are will be going through in Industry 4.0 is going to be phenomenal. One of the video is showing one accident has happened on the road and how the claim processing happens and how the truck comes for to take the accident vehicle and how the other car comes to pick him up and how this happens in a seamless way. In another video, there is a robot talking with the anchor in a newsroom. If it gets connected, then try. So moving next, if I have to give you one takeaway, then it very famous quote of Peter Drucker is the most effective way to manage change is change it to lead the change. So if you want to be successful, India moving from $2 trillion economy to $20 trillion economy, I suggest that you lead the change. You make the change happen. Most of you should be aspiring to become an entrepreneur. So my key takeaways to all of you would be, first, think big, collaborate, and co-create. Co-creation is very important. If you want to make something significant, you have to collaborate and co-create together. Dive deep into tumultuous change to understand trends. So many changes are happening. If you ask any CEO that where the company will be next 5 years, 10 years from now, it is becoming very, very difficult. We have to give you 10 years context before we can speak a line. So it is very essential for all of you also to develop a deep dive knowledge of your area that you want to focus on. Experiment, try out, implement. Government has also come out with tinkering labs where young students of 10th standards and 12th standards, they can also play around. So this experimentation mindset is very, very important. There are no one answer to every problem. So it's very essential that we have experiential mindset. And last but not the least, we need to be a life learner. Continuously keep on learning, educating ourselves. Also, because life gets too busy, we need to step back, connect to ourselves, and then only it will be a meaningful success in our life. Walt Disney's famous quote, all our dreams can come true if we have the courage to pursue them. All the knowledge and wisdom is fine unless we continue to work in our dreams and we put on the efforts which is required to make it happen. So if still there is a confusion, ask questions.
Hello, sir. I am Yati Nikam from BMHRD.
Yeah.
And my question is, when automation is taking the jobs, as you said, do you think still the typical traditional HR and IR policies will work out?
HR
and IR policies will work out the similar way?
HR is going, will go for a massive change. I'll give you an example. Airbus is one of the biggest aerospace company in the world. Okay? Now, they hired a design head who is 35 years old and he comes from Google. What he did in few months of his joining, he closed all the labs which were spread over many countries. He said that all of them are not relevant. So you can imagine Airbus is finding a talent in Google technology head. And this young boy comes and he removes most of the top 100 design people who have worked for ages. So what we used to call talent management 2 years back and what you call talent management now, it is a dramatic change. And in India, we think it is not happening. It is in a latency. That's why I said 2020, people will suddenly realize everything has changed. Dramatically changed. So IR and all, it will be still relevant. HR policies, IR will still be relevant, but the way you manage, the way you interact, the way you qualify talent, this could have gone a massive change.
Thank you, sir, for giving your valuable insight on a vast range of subjects ranging from globalization, economics, global warming to technology. Also, as most of the student managers present here perceive to be an entrepreneur someday, thank you for guiding us on the subject of entrepreneurship.